not just hear a word, but to act on it. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you,
amen.
Jesus.
Amen. Lord, I pray for every person who's here. Lord, I pray for your Holy Spirit. Lord, that you'd only speak the words that you want me to speak.
Amen.
And that everything that is good and pleasing and right would take root in hearts and minds. And anything that is not of you, Lord, that you would just blow it away. Lord, I stand in the shadow of your cross.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Who here can tell me what faith is?
A horse.
The horse.
Yeah, but it's nothing to see.
Timing is everything. Yeah, Brandon.
Believing though seeing.
Yep.
The substance of things that seem.
You got half of that, Carly. Half of it.
Obedience.
Yep. Anybody else?
Faith is love. Faith is a force of righteousness.
Mm-hmm. Yep. It's a gift.
Faith, yeah, Frank.
It's our greatest treasure.
It's our greatest treasure. Mm-hmm. It's also impossible to please God without faith. Mm-hmm. And John Havlick sent me a message this week, and I watched it, and I watched the first 5 minutes of it, and I got exactly what I needed to get. Mm-hmm. I don't think John knew about it. Because the rest of the message, I think, is what John wanted to convey to me. But have you ever sat in a service, and it was a good message, but you weren't really getting much out of it, and then the pastor just said one little phrase, and that one little phrase just stuck with you. And so in the message that John sent to me, this pastor was preaching, and he said something that just stuck with me. He said, faith is a force. And I just started to get the revelation of that, because have you ever heard God is faithful?
Amen. Mm-hmm.
And that's true, but we tend to think that that's an attribute of God, you know? And that's not necessarily wrong, but that's not strong enough. God is faithful. That's who he is. That's who he always will be. What is he faithful to? He's faithful to us. He's faithful to his word.
Yes.
See, the Bible says that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word. That's why it's so important. He wants us to hear his voice when he speaks to us.
Amen.
And he wants us to read his word.
Amen.
Faith is a force. I thought it was something inside me, and it is. But faith makes stuff happen because it's God who's doing the doing part of it.
Yes, Jesus.
Faith is a huge subject. I'm just going to talk about one little part of it. This force that's behind faith. I'm going to go to the next slide. This is the definition of faith as you'll read it in the dictionary. A strong or unshakable belief in something. Proof or evidence. It quotes Christianity, a trust in God and his actions and his promises. And it's even faith in something that is not seen. That's what faith is about, something you can't see it, you can't touch it. In Hebrews 11, if we go to the next slide, it says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Hope. Hope and assurance. Hope. Hope. What am I hopeful in? Yeah. I hope God will do what he said he would do. I hope. And the assurance. The assurance. Assurance. Insurance. Assurance that it actually will happen. Assurance of my hope in Him.
Amen.
We read Matthew, truly I tell you the truth, if you have faith and do not do, not only can you do what was done for the fig tree, but you can also say to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and it will be done. Now, how many of you have used your faith and it didn't happen right away? It took weeks. It took months. It took years.
Yeah.
You know, I'm reminded of the time my father-in-law had a dog. It was a golden retriever. And this dog just loved to pull on stuff, you know, like to have a tug-of-war contest. And my father-in-law said, oh, you'll never wear that dog out. And I took that as a challenge. And I tug-of-warred with that dog till finally he gave up. Because I knew that if I was patient enough, I would wear this dog out.
Amen.
But sometimes when we hear God's word, and we say, okay, I trust you in that, God. If you said it, and I'm praying for it because I need it, and I'm going to be obedient to it, then I'm going to have to be patient on this thing. Because Satan will see how long you're going to hold on to that word of God for.
Yeah.
Because he thinks if he can just wear you out, you'll give up. He knows that. He knows humankind. He's been doing this for centuries. If I can get you to worry and get impatient and not really trust God, I know I can knock you off this thing. I know eventually you'll let go of it. Let's go to the next slide. I'm going to talk out of my experience in the Word. Faith to me has kind of three essential components to it. There's an action that is incorporated into it, or an obedience thing. Now, obedience to what? Obedience to what God has said. Why? Because He knows what's best for me. As parents, you really get this. As parents and you've got a child, you tell your child certain things because you want what's best for them. You don't want them to get hurt. You want them to be healthy. You want to have fun with them. All these things. The child doesn't always get it, but the parent loves the child and has what's... So there's an obedience factor that's incorporated into this thing between us and God. So when God shares a word with us, whatever it's about, whether it's about relationships or our sexuality or about finances, we have a choice at that point to say, God, I'm going to do it your way. I'm going to do it your way. That's a real choice. Because I can say, that probably makes sense, God, but I'm going to do it my own way. And then I do it my own way, and I ask God, why didn't I get the results? We totally diluted that promise. Because we said, yeah, God, that's a good promise. I'll receive that, but then I'm going to go do it my own way. Doesn't work. Speaking in agreement to what God says is another important component. You remember Mary when the angel came to her? She said, let it be so according to what you've said. That activates something.
Amen.
When you come into agreement with what God says, Amen. You begin to activate something.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
And patience.
Thank you, Jesus.
Patience. This is the hardest one as humans that we have to struggle with, is the patience part. I'm not pregnant yet. We've been trying for a year. You know, patience. You know, just like that dog. You know, with me, I am never letting go, God. I've got my teeth into that word, and I'm never going to let go. Because to me, it's a life and death matter. I want that thing so bad, I'm not going to let go of it. Satan will try to wait you out. How long? Aren't you getting tired yet of believing his word? Aren't you tired of your neighbor, you know, getting pregnant and you're not pregnant yet? And didn't he say and stuff like that? But you know what I mean? You haven't got that job yet that you've been waiting for? And to Pastor Pitka's point, you know, about giving, I'm going to tie this in just a bit, but I have given money and I have sown it believing God to do his part. And I've done it specifically. And I can't tell you how many times, like testimony after testimony, my wife knows this. We've given a gift into the Lord, sown it into a ministry, and God has delivered. Action or obedience, speaking in agreement and patience. Let's go to the next slide. You guys probably know this story, Joshua and Jericho. What happens is we get a promise from God. What happens next? We encounter a problem right away. Right? God says, hey, go take that city. Well, those walls are like super high and they've got an army on top of there.
You got crippled back.
So you got the promise, then you get the problem. Now what? Obedience. God said, I want you to go walk around that thing. So what they do? They did. What happened when they got done? Nothing. Great. Okay? Obedience. What was next? Patience. Because when the angel came to Joshua and told him, Joshua said, okay. So he came into agreement. Mm-hmm. He was obedient. And now the patience part. Do it again. Next day. Can you imagine the people after about day six? I think they said this at day two. Like, hey, we feel like idiots. And the people on the wall are mocking them, okay? But what happens the seventh day? What happens the seventh day? Again, obedience. Okay, Joshua, you got your stuff? Yeah, I got my stuff. Hey, guys in the front, you got the trumpets? Yeah, we got the trumpets. We're ready. Let's go. Okay. All right, now everybody give a shout and blow the trumpets. Right? What happens? The walls come down. Did it happen the way Joshua expected it to happen? No.
Amen.
Because we always have an expectation of how God's going to do it.
Amen.
It's not about how God's going to do it. He's going to do it. What happens when you get fired from your job? That hurts. But God's trying to get you to something. He's trying to teach you something, and he's trying to get you to something. When I got fired from my job, I've been fired a couple times. It was devastating. But you know what? God gave me the increase. He gave me a better job.
Hallelujah.
More money.
Yes.
But I was devastated because I didn't understand at the time. I've gone 13 months without a job. I believe in this tithing thing.
Yeah.
I am sold out to this tithing thing.
It works.
Lots of testimonies about tithing. Where are we? Go ahead, James. He received the instructions. He received the word from the angel. He agreed with the angel. He obeyed. We saw what happened from that. He kept trusting God with the patience, and God delivered the end result. Again, The how it happens is up to God.
Yeah.
Let's go to our next one. Abraham, the father of many nations. So Abraham, he's old. He's like 90. His wife is old. They've been praying for children forever. An angel of the Lord comes and visits, gives him the word. Hey, Abram, you're going to be called father of many nations. You go. And he's like, what? And then he's like, let it be according to your word. So he comes together in agreement with his word. He received the instruction. He agreed. He obeyed. He started to anyways. And then what happened? Do you guys know the story? Year went by, no kids. Year went by, no kids. Year went by, no kids. Finally, now you have to understand this. When God gives you a word, it's for you and your family. Other people may not understand it completely.
Yeah.
And when you don't get the results right away, your family will start to coach you to go to the natural way of doing it the way you used to do it. They love you, don't get me wrong, but that word is for you. So when Abraham gets this word, what does his wife do? His wife overhears it and she laughs. Really? You know? That's a normal thing to do. But after a couple of years, she says, why don't you sleep with the maidservant? Like, this isn't working, so maybe God wants you to sleep with your maidservant. So, guess what? He does. Produces a child. That wasn't God's plan. And that child and that situation caused a lot of trouble. But what happened? Sarah gets pregnant. She has a child too. So God, yeah, she was old. She was in her 90s too. So we see that we have to be patient. The promise is still in effect. The force of faith is still in effect. He messed up. He thought he could help God. He listened to other people. Now there's listening to wisdom, but that advice from his wife was not wisdom. It was impatience. Let's go on. How about Noah? This is a great one. Noah is one of the few people who is having dialogue with God every day. And God says, I want you to build an ark. An ark. So what's he do? He says, okay, I'll do it. I don't necessarily get it, but I'll do it. And then he spends year after year cutting down these trees. And what happens? Everybody starts mocking him. Everybody starts mocking him. Noah, it's never rained before. They don't know what rain is. Do you know that? Never rained before. The earth was watered by the dew. Never rained before. The atmosphere was different. So what happens? He builds an ark on dry land. Gets mocked. What happens? God talks to him and says, you need to get all these animals in here. How am I going to do that? God says, I'll bring them. So God brings all the animals, loads up the ark. We know the story. It starts raining. When it starts raining, it's too late. God fulfilled his promise. But there's always a problem that comes with the promise. But Noah didn't give up. He didn't get the front half of the boat done and said, this is stupid, God. I'm tired. No, he kept going. He was patient with God. He kept talking to God every day.
Yeah.
Let's go to the next slide, James. How about Daniel in the lion's den? Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace? What happened? They loved God. What happened? The enemy tried to get them totally off track and said, you know what? You'll live. If you guys haven't read the story, I encourage you to do it. Mm-hmm. But one of the rules was, every time you hear the instruments play, what has to happen? You have to bow down and worship the idol, right? And if you don't, you'll get killed.
That's true.
So what did these guys do? They didn't. They trusted God. So they take these guys and they bring them before the fiery furnace. And the king's like, guys, last chance. You know, what did they say? Does anybody know what they said?
People don't read that Bible.
Our God will deliver us. Even if he doesn't, we're not going to bow.
Our God will deliver us. So what happened? Their words were matching up with God's word. Mm-hmm. What is God? He's our deliverer. But then what do they say? But even if he doesn't? Huh? You were just so confident a second ago, but you said, even if he doesn't? Because sometimes God's ways are higher than our ways. Amen. Because maybe they thought, well, if we die, we get to go see God right away.
Yeah.
So no biggie. Right? Our God will deliver us. But even if he doesn't, King, we want you to know we're not going to serve any other gods.
Amen. Never.
They go into the fiery furnace, and this is the part that I like. There is a fourth person in the furnace with them. When you are going through a hard time, there is a fourth person who's with you. Jesus is with you when you're going through that hard time.
Yeah.
And what happened when they went into the furnace? Everybody was shocked. What happened? People say, your God is the one and true God. And the king makes a declaration that everybody needs to serve the king of Shadrach, the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Mm-hmm. Wow. Faith is a force. Mm-hmm. God is on it. When you're in obedience and you're doing what he asked you to do and you're believing him, there is something supernatural that's happening.
Amen.
It's him.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I am watching over my word to see that it is fulfilled.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's go to the next one. So, I wanted to share a little bit about Renee and I because we speak out of our experience. And we can speak on this because God is no respecter of persons. His word applies to you and to you and to you as much as it does me.
Yes.
We're all his children. And so what I'm sharing with you, I'm sharing from the standpoint to give God glory. And I just wish everybody was, you know, I wish church was filled this morning. I was talking to God. God, there's so many people who need to hear this word, Lord. And I'm like, Jesus. And God says, yeah, now you know what I feel like. So you think you can come to church or not come to church, and that's totally cool. You know, go with the peace of God. He loves you. He loves you. But sometimes we need to come to church. Because we edify each other, we tell each other we love each other, we pray for people. Patrice, stand up for a minute. Let's stretch your hands towards Patrice for a minute. Patrice needs a job because he needs to qualify to go back to school.
Amen.
And he needs 30 hours a week now until September. So let's pray for Patrice for a minute. Lord, we pray for Patrice. You know what's best for him, Lord, if you want him in this course and the timing of this course, Lord. He's been actively sending out resumes and talking to people, Lord. And we just pray that you would bless him, Lord, and you'd give him a job for the summer that you can, he can apply himself to and for his culinary management program, Lord. It's like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We say, do it, Lord.
Yes.
We'd ask that you do it now.
Yes.
If it's your will. If it's not your will, we get it. And maybe there's something else for Patrice. But you asked us to ask in your name. So we're asking in the name of Jesus. The name that is above all names. That you'll give Patrice that job and those hours that he needs for his course. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So I'm a believer in this tithing thing because I've seen it go to work in my life. And we're not lucky people, are we, Renee? You know, it's not like we're lucky. We're followers of God.
Amen.
And I was talking about I was unemployed for 13 months. And when you're unemployed for 13 months as a guy, that's really hard because we take a lot of who we are or our self-esteem from the job that we do. So when we meet somebody, the first thing somebody says, hey, Mark, what do you do for a living? And I hated that. I hated meeting people because I knew they were going to ask me that question. And I got to a point where I was babysitting my nephews and nieces for spending money. And at the start of the day, the phone would ring. Or I'd want the phone to ring. And come 5 o'clock, it never rang. And that day was over. So I'd start off the morning with hope. God, you're my deliverer, you're my savior, I'm a tither. And by 5 o'clock, 5:10, I'm like, oh God, what are you waiting for? But I still trust you.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
And it was literally, like, if you imagine you had a backpack on and the zipper was open, and it was like every day Satan would put a brick in there. Every day at 5 o'clock, there'd be another brick. Hey, how's that tithing going for you, Mark? Yeah, God's really blessing you, isn't he? Yeah, maybe you should stop preaching that for a while, don't you think? It's not working, is it? But I said, God, you're faithful. I don't get it. I don't understand it. But you know what God was doing? He was stripping away every ounce of pride that I had in my job and in myself. And now, whatever I do, whatever I'm successful at, it's him. It's not
Hallelujah.
Me.
Yes.
It's him.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
But it took that. It took 13 months of stripping all that junk out of my life. Jesus. And I have a deeper appreciation now for people who are unemployed and who are looking for work. And I want to pray. And Renee knows I've prayed for people and helped people get jobs. I'm passionate about it now. But God was working all of that in me. He didn't forget about his promises. Mm-hmm. They were all still there. Faith was still working. So many stories. We've given away tens of thousands of dollars and cars and jewelry. Why? Because it's not an idol in my life anymore. Because I would rather have the power than the money. What do you mean, Mark? Power to do what? Do you guys remember 2008? All the banks started crashing. All the stock market started crashing. All your investment funds, if you're, you know, thinking about retirement, the value of those mutual funds, 40%. You thought you were going to retire? Guess what? Crash. There is nothing you can invest in that is lasting. People will steal it. The bank will, corruption, you can't trust anything, ultimately. Like if you think about it. Talk about all the people that got swindled by their bankers or by their lawyers, you know, thought it was safe, or how'd this guy get away with it? So the reason I'm a giver is because I want the power of the Most High's provision in my life.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Pastor Pinka talked about not worrying. I don't worry anymore.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Much. Because I still think about things. You know, like, okay, retiring, how much am I going to need? And then I go, yeah, that's smart. But not to worry about it, not to be obsessed by it anymore. It doesn't rule me anymore. And if you want to talk about generosity, when you give generously, you know what it's like? It's like you're a little crazy because you don't care about it anymore and you're just trusting him to do it, to backfill that thing for you.
Yeah.
Why? Because he said it. Remember Pastor Pinker read Matthew 6? How does it? And his righteousness and all these things will be given to you as well. It's written in red letters. He said it. It's a promise. You can count on it.
Yes.
Oh. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Honest.
Yes.
Why? Because I know it. Because he said it. And I've told you, it takes a little bit of patience sometimes. But there's power in that. There's a force happening. When you write out that check to the homeless shelter or to the church, or you give somebody, you know, hundreds of dollars because you know they're broke and desperate, there is a force that's activated that is now pushing on your life and pushing back on Satan and everything that he's trying to take from you. Uh-huh. Why? Because he loves you. Because he said it. If he didn't mean it, he wouldn't have said it.
Yeah.
Last slide. Oh my, but his love, his promises, they will never fail.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
When you start to get that in your spirit, that his love never fails, mm-hmm. you start to get a bit freer.
Yep.
And when you go through that hard time, you go back on that promise. You go back on his love never fails. And I can say it now and dance it now, but during those 13 months, it was really hard. But I got my word of my mouth into agreement with the words that he spoke. I started to do it his way, meaning I started to come into obedience financially with him. Sexually with him, honored my wife. When you start to get yourself in alignment with the way God does things, you start to experience God results. So we do what we know how to do in the natural, and he adds the supernatural. Remember Joshua? Joshua did what he was told to do in the natural, and then God added the supernatural. Slide. Faith is a force.
Yeah.
Can we pray? Can we pray? Lord, your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out of us. Lord, your love never fails. And I thank you for your word that you've written. And you said, here it is, take it and use it, it works. Thank you for the fellowship of the saints that are here this morning. Lord, we want to tell you, as we did in worship, that we love you and that you are great, you do miracles so great. And Lord, for every person who's not here, Lord, I just pray that you would bless them, Lord, that you would encourage them, Holy Spirit, that you would speak to them because you love them. Thank you, Lord, for Dunamis Church and the saints who are here today. Lord, we pray that you would bless this word to our hearts. Lord, that we, when we have a problem or a difficulty, Lord, we go to your word first. Instead of worrying, you know, coming into despair, we go to your word. We love you, Lord. We just want to give you all the glory.
Yes, Jesus.
And all the honor.
Jesus.
And as we started the service out, we said, Jesus,
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 high and lifted up.
Yes, Jesus.
We bless
yes,
you,
Jesus.
Lord, I pray for every need here this morning, Lord.
Yes.
For every need.
Yes.
You say you know our needs.
Yes.
But seek ye first your kingdom and your righteousness, and you'll look after our needs.
Hallelujah.
Relationships,
yes.
Physical needs,
yes.
Financial needs, emotional needs.
Amen.